This video will explain Java RMI, and that will be done with the help of a program which is the usual chat program, this time using RMI. Let's have a look at the packages. We note immediately that the net packages are gone, both at the client side and the server side. And that's great, right? Now we don't have to bother about communication ourselves. It's done by RMI. That's the beauty of this. The other thing to note is that there is no client-side controller. The task of the client-side controller in the socket-based versions was to handle the network communicating threads. Now we don't have any such handling anymore, and that is in fact an oversimplification, because as was explained in the previous video, Java RMI has no multi-threading on the caller side, only on the callee side. So in fact the client is not multi-threaded in this example, and the user interface will hang if the server is slow to answer. The reason I made this not very appropriate simplification is first that you are allowed to do the same thing in the homework to render the homework a bit easier, and the second reason is to really emphasize the fact that the RMI call looks exactly like a local method call. We will just do an ordinary method call and it will be directed directly to the server. Okay, so I will run this program because it behaves slightly different than the socket-based chat programs. So first let's start the server. Okay, the server is running. Then let's start the client. Client is also running, and then we log in my IP address. Instead of connecting, the command is now login. Specify the host of the server to which to log in, and specify username and password. So there is no check. Password can be anything. Okay, login was successful, so then Stina can start sending. So the username that was specified at login is the ID presented during the conversation. Okay, let's start another client. Login also this client. And as in the previous versions of the program, the newly logged in user gets the entire conversation up to this point and then can start communicating. So in fact it's also possible to change username. Maybe Stina changed name to Fia and communicating. Okay, and then quit as usual. Okay, so that's the chat program. Now I will explain how the concepts of an object-oriented middleware explained in this image here are implemented in the Java RMI. So if you feel uncertain about this image, then you should again watch the video on object-oriented middleware where all this is explained. At the same time, when I explain how these concepts are implemented in Java RMI, it will also become clear how to write a Java RMI program. Okay, so let's start with the interface, this thing here. So that interface defines the methods that can be called remotely, and it's used to create the stub of the object that can be called remotely. Because as you can see here, the stub implements the same interface. So remember that these two interfaces are the same. So that interface is placed in the common package because it will appear at both client and server side. And in fact there are two such interfaces, chat client and chat server, because in this program both client and server can be called remotely. The client can call the server and the server can call the client. The server has to call all clients when broadcasting messages. So those interfaces in fact define the communication protocol by defining the methods that can be called remotely. First, the server's remote interface. As I explained in the video on object-oriented middleware, an object that can be called remotely must implement the remote interface. And this interface that defines the remote methods extends the remote interface, Java RMI remote. And that way, the implementing class will also implement the remote interface. So first thing to do when creating a Java RMI program is to decide which methods shall be called remotely and create an interface that defines those methods, and that interface must extend the Java RMI remote interface. So here are the methods that can be called remotely. First there is the login method that accepts the remote object of the client. So this is the remote object of the client object that can be called remotely when broadcasting messages. And the credentials, username and password, this is just an object holding the username and password that has no behavior. So just constructors, setters and getters. So that's the login method. Then there is this method to change nickname. So remember that the user could change name. Broadcast message, the one that is used to send the message to all other clients. And leave conversation, which is called when a client shuts down. So those were the remote methods clients can call on the server. Then let's see the remote methods that a server can call on the client. And that is just one, receive message, which the server calls when sending messages to clients. We have some clients, and one of them wants to broadcast a message. The client invokes the broadcast MSG method, passing the message, and the server will then call the receive message method, this one, the receive message, on all clients, passing the same string. Okay, so that's how a message is sent from one client to all other clients. So now we've seen the remote interfaces. That's the first thing to do, define remote interfaces. Then let's immediately move on to this thing here, to export. So remember that we have to make the object-oriented middleware, that is Java RMI in this case, aware of the fact that the remotely callable object exists. So then let's see the class implementing the remote interface. On the server side, that is the controller. So that is quite common practice, to expose the controller. There's no need for a net package. We immediately expose the controller method. So the client calls methods remotely in the server's controller. Here is the server's controller, and we can see that it implements the chat server interface, and it also extends unicast remote object. That is because of one thing, namely that the export operation is performed in the constructor of the unicast remote object. When is the constructor of the unicast remote object called? To know that, we must understand a bit of constructor execution in a Java program. Let's draw these objects that exist here. At the base of this inheritance hierarchy, we have the JavaLang object, which is the base class of all Java classes. It is inherited by the unicast remote object. Here you can see unicast remote object. So this solid line means inheritance, and the unicast remote object is inherited by the controller. Okay, so when we create a new object of this controller, what happens is that first the constructor is executed in the controller, then the constructor is executed in the superclass, unicast remote object, and then in the superclass of that class, object. Here is the constructor of the controller. It does nothing, it is empty. After this constructor is executed, the constructor of the superclass unicast remote object will be executed. So even if we do not write anything in the constructor here, it is as if it called the superclass constructor. And in the constructor unicast remote object, the export operation is performed. And that is why the object that implements the remote interface also extends unicast remote object to handle exporting. Okay, so now we've seen how to create an object that can be called remotely. The steps were to first define the remote methods in the interface, and then to create the implementing class. Define remote methods and implement remote methods. There is one more small thing here. So each call to a remote method, of course, results in a network call, and the network call might fail, and then the Java RMI framework will throw a remote exception. So that is why all methods in the remote interface must be declared to throw remote exception. The remote exception is never thrown in our code here, but it might be thrown by Java RMI. This image here, which is also from the previous video on object-oriented middleware, shows that the call from the client to the remote method will result in a network call here inside the Java RMI framework, and the remote exception might be thrown somewhere from down here or here. And then that exception will arrive at the caller. So therefore, all methods in the interface must be declared to throw remote exception. So again, the remote exception is normally thrown somewhere inside the framework in the yellow code, not at the callee implementation, the object on the callee side that is called remotely. So then it's time to explain how the registry works in Java RMI. And to remind you, what we have to look at are the bind and also the lookup operations. And we also have to see how to start the registry. Let's start by starting the registry. That is done in the main of the server. So in Java RMI, the registry must always run as on the same node as the callee object. You can only bind to a registry on the same IP address. And that is for security reasons, in order not to be able to manipulate some other's registry. So this is the main method of the server. First we call the private method start registry down here. So what we do here is we use a static method in the class locate registry. So locate registry is a utility class that can be used to find and to start a registry. Okay, so we call the getRegistry method, which will return a reference to a registry, and that is the registry type. The registry object that is returned by getRegistry is in fact the remote interface of the registry. So if we look at this image, there is a remote reference defining methods that can be used in the registry. And this interface is called registry. And that is what is implemented by the registry stub. And this registry interface, of course, extends the Java RMI remote interface that must be extended by any interface defining remote methods. This bind operation performed by the callee is actually done to an object implementing the registry interface. And that object is the registry stub. So in this case, you must understand, the callee is the caller of the registry. The registry is the remote object that is receiving the RMI call, and the callee, the thing binding, is performing a remote call to the registry. And this remote call is the bind operation. Okay, but before we can bind, we have to start. And here we call the method list that will list all objects that are already bound in the registry. There are no such objects since we're just starting it. But the purpose here is to realize whether there is a registry running or not. Because if there is no registry running, then the list method will throw an exception. And then we come here and we can call the static method createRegistry that will start the registry. And it will run on the well-known port registry port 1099 defined in the registry interface. Okay, so when start registry returns, the registry is running. And now we use another utility class, naming. So there exists a utility class called naming that has static methods. So this bind operation is directed to the naming class, which will then call bind on the registry. So the naming class exists to relieve us of the burden to look up the registry. If we know that the registry is already running, there is no need for the code here to locate the registry. And here we call rebind, which is similar to bind. The difference is that with rebind, we can bind even if there was already an object bound under that name. We just change the object that is bound. Okay, and here we store the controller. The controller is the object that is supposed to be called remotely, so we pass it to the registry. And the name under which we bind it in the registry is a constant in the controller class. Then there is the lookup, when the client retrieves the remote reference to the controller. So that is of course performed in the client. In the U, I'm looking interpreter. In this method here, lookup server. So here we again use the utility class naming and call it static method lookup. Here you can see that we really don't have to find the registry. There's no need to use the locate registry to retrieve the registry remote object. We just call the static method lookup. So just to clarify, also on the client side, we can use the naming class. So lookup is now made to the naming class, which then forwards the call to the registry stub and onto the registry this call here. And the controller remote object will be returned by the registry. So what are we looking up? This is a URI. Well, it's a URL without the protocol part. We start with two slashes, then the host, and then the default port. No port is specified here, so it's the default port 1099 is used. Then the slash, and then the name under which the callee was bound in the registry. And this is the same constant that was used when binding. That way there's no risk of misspelling the name. And the registry returns the remotely callable object, the controller in this case, that was bound in the registry. Okay, so now we know also how the registry is handled in the Java RMI application. So next, let's have a look at examples of call by value and call by reference. Let's start with call by value. Call by value, as you might remember, means that an object is passed either as parameter or returned value, and that object is copied to the receiving side, and that is what happens in the login call. Then the credentials object is passed. So credentials is an object containing username and password, and that object is copied to the server. And pass by value is appropriate here because this object just contains data. It has no behavior and is in no way linked to the client, the caller side. The only purpose of this object is to pass the data to the server, the callee side. Let's have a look at this credentials object. So you can see that it implements Java IO serializable. And as you might remember, that was the requirement for an object that is passed by value. So the stub during the marshalling process will create a serialized version of this credentials object, and at the receiving side during the unmarshalling, a copy of this credentials object will be created. Next, let's have a look at pass by reference, and that in fact happens in the same call, the login call, where there is also an object that is passed by reference, namely this my remote object. Let's have a look at the definition of the login method in the chat server remote interface. Here is the chat client object that is passed by reference. The chat client is in fact the remote interface of the client, defining the client's method that can be called remotely. So what actually happens is that there is a client that logs in to the server. The client creates an instance of the chat client interface, which has the receive message method. And the class implementing this chat client interface is an inner class in the non-blocking interpreter, the class handling the user interface on the client side. It's this class, console output. It implements the remote interface and it extends Unicast remote object. The constructor here is where the call is made to the constructor of Unicast remote object, where this object is exported, and the export operation might throw a remote exception. Okay, and here is the implementation of the receive message method defined in the chat client interface, and it just prints to the console. Right, so the console output class implemented the chat client interface. Of course, the console output class also has the receive message method, but I will not draw that here to save some space. So when the client calls the login method on the server, it passes a reference to this object. The client has created a reference to that object implementing the remote interface, and that reference is passed to the server in the login operation. That is this reference here. So then the server also has a reference to the same object. Actually, the reference on the client side is no longer of important. It's not used anymore there. The important thing is that the server now has a reference to an object on the client side. So later, when the server wants to broadcast messages, say that another client up here called broadcast message, this operation on the server, passing some string, then the server can now call receive message. Nice, isn't it? The server can call receive message on the client, on all clients in fact. And that call, it's a remote call to the client. And this console output then will just print the message to the screen. So the remote object enables the server to make a callback to the client. This call is called a callback. So of course the chat client interface extends the interface Java RMI remote. Okay, this is an interface. Right, so that is how a pass by reference is performed in Java RMI, and it enables the server to make this callback. Okay, so we are done covering Java RMI, and everything related to constructing a Java RMI application has been explained in this chat program. But before finishing the video, I'd like to show that there are two classes in the model that have not been mentioned so far. They have nothing to do really with Java RMI, just with the functionality of the program. Therefore, I'll quickly mention them. Participant and participant manager. So participant here means a participant in the chat conversation, that is a chat client. So it's the participant manager that knows all participants. It maintains a table containing all existing participants. And each participant is identified by an ID number. So this class is responsible for sending the entire conversation when a new participant has joined, searching in its table for a particular participant, removing a participant from the table, and broadcasting a message to all participants. Then there is the participant class, which represents one individual participant, and it holds data related to a specific participant, and also has the method send to send the message to particular chat client, because it's the participant that holds the remote object of a particular client. Each participant object represents one chat client and thus holds the remote object of that client. Those were the participant manager and participant classes. And that's all about the chat application and also about Java RMI.